everybody, and welcome to another video iWoops. Although today we may also be releasing this as an audio iWoop. We'll see. We might be trying something new today. At any rate, today we'll be talking about the research that Dr. Dunbar here did at Cal, one of the largest research studies, if not the largest, ever done on canine domestication.
Well, it was the longest, yeah, 30 years. It started in Yale and then ended up at UC Berkeley.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're doing this because you're currently giving some exciting new seminars that are bringing some of the insights you learned from this research and applying them to modern pet dog training. So I thought everyone would be kind of interested in hearing what that research was like, how you got started doing it, and you know, what a day in the life of a canine dog behavior researcher was.
I have two questions already.
I didn't get a word out of my mouth. Yeah. What?
How it started at Yale, how and why did it come to Berkeley, and where in the 30-year period did you come into this?
I was there for the last 10 years. It was run by Dr. Beach, and he was at Yale until Berkeley poached him.
Oh.
And they offered him...
Go Cal.
And basically the field station was what did the deal. So we had a big place where we kept a colony of dogs.
To talk about Dr. Beach a little bit, I know that he's your personal hero.
He's a wonderful guy, taught me so much, and he wouldn't have guessed it then, but he has actually changed dog training a lot. That he was the person who taught me to objectively observe, to be precise, that, you know, rather than arguing about your opinion, hey, fact is fact, you said to sit, the dog's not sitting. That's the way I look at training, and I count numbers on everything. And that's what a true behaviorist is, which I guess a lot of people don't know, because now everyone and their grandmother calls themselves the behaviorist.
So Dr. Beach, he started at Yale, and did he have a colony of dogs there?
Yes. Yeah, okay. But they were in a building.
Okay.
When they moved to Berkeley, they were in the California sunshine.
So where did he get where did he get the starter pack of dogs?
Well, they started laboratory beagles. I mean, the beagle's the dog that's used in most research.
Beagles lucked out. They didn't have to have any...
Well, yeah, these beagles, I loved it when we took them out of cages and put them outside in great big enclosures.
Mm-hmm.
They dug dens. It was wonderful, because you had to have dog houses by law. You get inspected, so many dogs, you had to have dog houses. They never used them.
Uh-huh.
They didn't want to go in a dog house. We lived in California. So they dug these little dens below ground.
Uh-huh.
I thought that's so cool, because they've never been on Earth in their lives. They came out of, you know, laboratory.
Right. So it was like this group of dogs that Dr. Beach started with, they were breeding with each other, or were there new dogs coming in?
No, not willy-nilly. We were studying, yes, I mean, we obviously had puppies when we decided to study development, but first we started with adult dogs, and we were just looking at sexual behavior, male sexual behavior, female sexual behavior. That in itself is fascinating, and it's why I'm doing these one-day lectures. I love it, that female dogs and male dogs are unlike any other mammal. And all the things we take for granted, say the female cycle, we have cyclic behavior. And so the first sign that you're pregnant is you miss a cycle. Well, you can't do that in dogs, because you see, pregnancy is shorter than the cycle. The cycle is 6 months long.
That's the only mammal?
Yeah, so we call it, they are seasonally monoestrous, whereas most mammals are polyestrous or seasonally polyestrous. So this then gives whole sorts of problems. How can you predict when she's going to ovulate?
Right.
Most breeders haven't got a clue. But we discovered how to do it by observing behavior alone. We can predict ovulation to within 24 hours.
Hmm.
Cool.
And this was figured out at Yale still? Or?
No, this is we're in Berkeley now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's go back to Kelly's question about how, why did it leave Yale?
Because Dr. Beach was poached, and he was the study.
They showed, they gave him a fancy new place for his beagles.
They gave him a wonderful place, and so he changed.
Mm-hmm.
And
but he'd been already doing that for 20 years.
Wow. And I joined it 10 years before the end. I was actually in Africa, and I was kind of panicking. What would I do when I qualified as a vet? And I thought, you know, I liked obstetrics, and I liked cows and dogs.
Mm-hmm.
So first I flipped a coin, it came down dogs. which I'm really feel cool about. Mm-hmm. I still love cows, but it changed because
yeah.
with
changes
dogs,
everything.
We have owners, dog owners. You don't, you know,
so
farmers.
It's a social
world
that you've joined, plus a more mainstream.
I still like the calmness of cows, but
mm-hmm.
so then, you know, and I just discovered this behavior stuff in 67.
Yeah.
So I put them together, obstetrics, behavior, sexual behavior of dogs, and I started writing around. I actually asked a professor at college who put me in touch with Michael Fox,
mm-hmm.
who went to Royal Veterinary College the same as I did, and he said, well, you should write to Frank Beach, which I did, and he sent me back this single-space, three-page letter that said, come join the program, take a PhD, and I'll pay you all this money. And I was like, wow.
Yeah.
And I got here, and what we did was we watched dogs. I mean, it was fantastic.
So, yeah, what was a day in the life of... California.
We'd try and get up there at 9 in the morning.
Did you really?
I'm not a morning person,
yeah.
as you know.
Believe it if I saw it.
And we would watch the dogs for about 2 hours, maybe 2.5 hours, and that was it, because then the dog said, we're going to sleep now. So, unless you want to watch dogs sleeping, which we actually did as a study. We did a study on who sleeps next to whom.
Mm-hmm.
And we found interesting stuff, like two pairs of dogs. The closest dog to Ken was always Peggy.
Mm-hmm.
The closest dog to Peggy is always Ken. And the same with Joe and Cassius. They slept together, they lived together, but if ever there was a fight in the colony, it was Joe and Cassius.
Well,
I mean,
fighting over bed space. Somebody snores too loud or something.
So basically, it was observational research. We observed dogs. So first we would watch them mate, and then we'd write down every behavior they do, and then we would come up with codes for them so we could write down a shorthand. Then we would write down frequencies and sequences. And so you learn, if a male dog puts his chin over a female dog's back, he's going to jump on and mount her and hump. So
mm-hmm.
you learn that some behaviors predict others. And then we morphed into sexual differentiation, how the male and female dogs develop differently.
Mm-hmm.
And then the big thing, big difference there, of course, is aggression.
Mm.
And that was just so cool. And then...
What do you mean the big difference is aggression?
Well, that males generally fight more than females. So if there's a fight in the dog pack, it's usually a male-male fight. And so we got 5 adult male dogs and 5 adult female dogs. And then we would test them with valued objects like bones and what have you.
Huh.
And we found that male dogs have an absolutely rigid fixed hierarchy, which is the same every day. We tested it for 10 years, and it was the same every day, with the
mm-hmm.
exception of 2 days, when Joe and Cassius reversed. But the top dog was Ken, and when Ken died, we replaced him with another dog called Cerberus. And it was very interesting then. The top dog was Eddie, who was the smallest male.
He was second in line to Ken?
He was second in line to Ken. And the second top dog was Cassius, the second smallest dog.
Huh.
Right down to the bottom dog
right.
was Whip, the largest dog. And we had a rank that was absolutely stable, but inversely correlated with weight.
Really?
Which, of course, doesn't make sense at all.
Completely.
Absolutely. Perfect. 100% inverse correlation.
Mm-hmm.
So I showed it to Dr. Beach, and he's like, oh, wow. Because both of us knew it doesn't make sense. So we then knew what our next study was. We had to look at development.
Mm.
Because, of course, the rank was perfectly correlated with age.
Huh.
You see, Eddie was the smallest dog, but he was the oldest. So when Cassius is growing up underneath him, he may end up being bigger, but
mm-hmm.
he's not bigger when he's growing up.
Right.
This is when we cottoned on to this dominant stuff is rubbish.
Mm-hmm.
And what because there's no contest developmentally. You get it?
Right.
And so basically, we then knew our next part of the study was we need puppies, we need to watch them grow up and develop their hierarchies, and magical, we realized it's not this sort of Mickey Mouse dominance hierarchy that's black and white, it's
mm-hmm.
rich, it's sophisticated, has a lot of innuendo, it's really not much different from human relationships.
And so it begins, the puppies come and... That's
yeah.
a whole new
exciting
adventure.
New chapter.
It's,
huh?
Oh, it's wonderful, and it's...
All right, well, we'll have to have another episode to talk about that in and of itself.
Oh, one episode won't be anywhere near sufficient.
Well, to give people a taste of right of the practical and
yeah.
theoretical
stay tuned.
Fruits of your labor. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.